weather's finally turned a little, and that's great. But we will see. Florida's very unpredictable. Let's have a word of prayer. Let's kneel, please. Heavenly Father, mighty King, we thank you for the Sabbath day again. We praise you for this time we have to come away from the world and to worship you. Father, we pray that our worship is acceptable to you, not our way, but your way. And we ask that your spirit and your ministering spirits are here with us this day, that we do your will. In Jesus' most holy name we pray, amen. We've been dealing with the dreaded book of James, theologians' nightmares. Because why? Why do theologians and preachers do not like the book of James? You very rarely hear sermons on the book of James. Why? Because it takes the authority from man and gives it to God. And it's actually in the New Testament. It redefines a lot of things that he does through the Holy Spirit, of course, that the church wants power over, but clearly says no. He, being the Holy Spirit. Who's in charge of the church on earth? Who was given that job? You will get from the Christian the answer what? Jesus, of course. Really? Is that what Jesus said? Who's in charge of the church on earth? The Holy Spirit. What did Jesus say? Who did he say would be the teacher? Who did he say would lead men in God, in his law? Who did he say? Him or the Holy Spirit? See, the Holy Spirit's been detached from the church since Jesus left. Because when we put him where he belongs, there's no need for man to intercede between God and us. What does Paul say is the Holy Spirit's job with our prayers? Who intercedes on our prayers? What does he say? The Holy Spirit cleans them up, presents them, and makes them acceptable. And where do the prayers go when that happens? We say a prayer. Paul says we don't know what we really want. We don't know how to pray. Isn't that what he says? He says, but the Holy Spirit intervenes. He cleans those prayers up. And what does he do with them then? What does he do with them? What does Jesus have before the throne? What is he carrying? What does he have? He has a piece of the furniture of the sanctuary in his hand. What is it? The high priest carried it on the Day of Atonement. What is it, Reginald? I know you know the answer to that. It's the golden censer. See, the prayers go in there and become a sweet savor to the Father. Why do they become a sweet savor? See, Adventists need to know this stuff because right now in the Adventist church, it's being taught that there's no sanctuary in heaven. You know that, right? Why is it a sweet savor? Why? What makes it so to the Father? I'm going to answer that with another question. How does judgment work? Remember, the book of the saved was written before the foundations of the earth. That's simple. Everybody's in it unless we choose not to be in it. But how does judgment work? What does this have to do with the book of James? Judgment is simple. Your name comes up in the judgment, or my name, and Jesus either says, judge him as you would me, or he says nothing. It's that simple. Does that make sense? So, in the golden censer goes the prayers, and what makes them a sweet savor to the Father? Understanding that. Whose blood gets mingled with it? Christ's blood. You see, this is what the book of James is all about. So where is man in that situation? Where is he? Where is the church in that situation? Where is position in the church in that situation? Peter tells us, and also in the Old Testament, in a couple of different places, that we're all a royal, holy priesthood. What does that mean? That we become subservient to a church, to a leadership, or that we go out and spread the gospel? More through our actions than through what we say. So, we're in the book of James. James points all these things out. And again, that doesn't mean we do away with the church. But then, when we understand these things, the next question begs to be, what is the church and who is the church? Because you see, the high priest is wearing the church. There's no building here, is there? Where's the building? Because the building was destroyed. But where's the building here? It's a person. This is not Jesus. This is not an image of him. This is the high priest. This is what he would look like. However, this is what Jesus wears in the sanctuary that's not in heaven. But you see, the church is right here, that little piece. And I point to that and talk about that a lot. It means holiness to the Lord, which means I will write my laws upon their minds and their hearts. The church is where? Paul says, do you not know that what? Who's the church? We are. As a building, an organization, or as a people? I got a phone call this week from a guy up in Washington State. Got to think sometimes. The zip code or the area code runs through my mind. But anyhow, and he was quite impressed with the book that we had mailed out a couple weeks ago, because we had done books at that time instead of the brochures. And his question, I had quite a long conversation with him. He kept coming around to, who is Israel? And I know after the second time he asked the question where he was going with it. It's a white supremacist group. Well, their definition of America is quite interesting. And we're going to talk about that very thing, racism and prejudice, today, because James talks about lust, which is not the theological definition that we get from the preachers that James is talking about, or that the Bible talks about. He was kept alluding to that. I wouldn't give him the satisfaction. I knew where he was going. Very pleasant man. Knew about the seventh-day Sabbath. But this is what he was involved in. He never said it. I just knew that's where he was going. He was waiting for me to say it. And it's sad that this is what's being gleaned out of the scriptures, folks. I got another call from a lady who was very clear to let me know she was an atheist. And I said, then throw the book in the garbage. No, I'm going to burn it. I said, well, it's cool there. It might keep you warm. That's fine. And I didn't say it sarcastically, but that was how, I'm not going to get in an argument with these people. And she wanted me to know she didn't want any more mail. Well, you know full well when you open those things that they're addressed as a mass mailing, because who are they addressed to? A person or a resident? You see, you know when you get junk mail what it is. So you got both sides of the coin, extremes. You see, the book of James cuts through all that. Because when we answer to God through his system, and saying what I said before, that doesn't mean that Jesus, about the Holy Spirit being in charge of the church of the earth, on the earth, he's running it. But Jesus is in charge. But the Holy Spirit is running the church, not men. That was my point. God did not leave it without direct oversight. Let's continue keeping these few things in mind with this thing about lust. And what is the definition of lust, by the way? We talked about this last week. It is not a sexual thing. What is it? A strong desire to break the law. However, the sexual thing is in there too. But whenever you hear lust in church, what is it referred to? Always. When we see it in the Bible, make no doubt about it, at Baal Peor, what went on there? The whole situation was driven by one word, lust, which came down to idol worship, apostasy. When you look through the Bible, you find that word all over the place, and it's not always applied to that. There is a specific word in the Bible. When I say that, I'm talking about sexual desire. There is a specific word in the Bible that deals with that. My wife pronounces it very well. I cannot. What is it, Rita? Everybody pronounces that word differently, okay? But that word, when you see that, that is directly related to sexual behavior. The word lust, however, is not. It is the general downfall of the human race. And, well, let me put it to you this way. You can describe what the devil did in heaven with one word, lust. What did he want? He desired to do what? Break the law. Adam and Eve, what happened at the tree? Did the devil not say to her what she should not do? Did she repeat what she should not do? And then she went ahead and did it? That's lust. She broke the law, no, full well knowing. That's lust. The rest of it is all symptoms. Appetite, immorality, greed. It's all symptoms of the word lust. Yeah, Rita, you want to spread you? You got the mic? It's all symptoms. And James here, in these verses we were looking at, go ahead, dear.
Well, even in the Garden of Eden, she was not lusting after the fruit to eat. She was lusting after the knowledge that she thought that she was being denied.
Exactly. I'm glad somebody picked up on that. She wanted exactly what the devil wanted. And he beguiled her. What does that word mean? We have a word for it today. No, we have a specific word for that today. Beguiled is a specific thing. It's not just deceived, and it's not tricked. We call it linguistic programming. It's a form of hypnotism. You cannot overcome the devil. That's why you need the Holy Spirit. You see? He can, and he will, and he will not argue with him. He will shut him down and protect you. That's what our armor's all about. He beguiled. The word beguiled is used. That's a form of hypnotism. She went where she shouldn't have gone, which was Adam's fault. He should not have allowed it to happen. But then, we know the rest of the story, but then Adam loved her so much, he would not allow her to be destroyed. So he did the same thing. So he had some of his father's attributes, did he not? And here we are. That is the word lust. There's test and there's temptation. Temptation. James talks about that. And that's FM interference. But anyhow, we talked about all that, the tempted and the tested. God tests, he does not tempt. Ergo, the tree of good and evil in the garden. He told them, don't touch it. Who tempted him to touch it? God did, or the devil did? Adam and Eve did what they were not supposed to do. They lusted after the fruit. I don't think she wanted to have sex with it. So you see, that doesn't apply if that's the only way you believe that. She wanted to become like whom? Who wanted to do that in the beginning? Ooh, isn't that interesting? And he made her believe, did she really want that, folks? Did she really want that? No, she did not. But the devil beguiled her or hypnotized her, however you want to look at it. No, oh, we can't really say that. I mean, you know, this is 2015. We're advanced humans. Nobody can do that to us. Folks, this generation now is more beguiled than anyone that's ever walked this earth. And if you don't believe that, go into a school. These poor kids. They're bombarded from birth with all kinds of garbage. They can only be lustful. And I've said this 1,000 times. I remember when I was a kid, I used to read the fact that Mrs. White said that it would come to a point where nobody would accept Christ on the earth anymore, and that would be the end. That was impossible in my mind. Well, you know what? Not so much anymore. Not so much anymore. And it's sad. breaks my heart. Even to see the Seventh-day Adventist Church, whether it's conference or independent, just God's professed people going down the trail they're going down, is outrageous. So we see all these things. Last week we left off in Matthew 4, and I want to go back there because I want to pick it up from there, because here we see Jesus being tempted because he was Jesus. Is that why he was being tempted? Again, who put the test out there? Who did it? Who allowed it to happen? Well, Matthew was very clear as to who allowed it to happen. Verse 1, chapter 4. Then was Jesus led up by whom? What spirit would that be? The one that wasn't there at the time, many Christians will tell you. The one that was not on earth at the time. Have you heard that before from Christians? Oh, the Holy Spirit didn't come until after Jesus. Really? Well, what is that? And it's capitalized. What does that mean? The same one that was at his baptism? The same one that is in Genesis verse 2? That clearly says that the Spirit was at creation? That, folks, is theology at work. To believe that the Holy Spirit wasn't there. But here it says that the Spirit, God's plan for his Son was that he get tested. The devil's plan was that he gets what? Tempted. Now James says, and these are the verses we're looking at, that when we are tempted, what happens? We allow it to happen in our mind, we carry it out, boom, we're done. We talked about the fact Jesus was sustained for 40 days in the wilderness, not quite like Moses was. He felt it after 40 days. Moses never felt it. But the possibility of it being that way is in the Bible elsewhere. And this blows my mind about theologians. You come away from this with three things in mainstream Christianity. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and what's the other one? Pride of life. Where do they get that from that? Where do they get that? It's not in there. One word. The devil was seeking to make the Father's Son do what? Willfully break the law exactly the way Eve did it. He wanted to create a desire in him at his weakest point. And by the way, Eve was at her weakest point too. Why do I say that? She was healthy. I don't know when she had eaten last. She may not have been hungry. Of course, many of us eat, and I'm speaking of for myself, when I'm not hungry, only because it looks good. Oh, I haven't had that in a long time. Yeah, well, probably didn't need it. But anyhow, it's the same situation. Is it not? Because the devil opens up, of course, more cleverly, because Eve's more naive than this Jesus is. He's lived here all at this point, 30 years. He's not happy with what he's seen. He's very well versed. He grew up in the ghetto. Did Eve grow up in the ghetto? Did she? He's not a naive man as a human. And we have to be careful how we refer to Christ's humanity. Though he were God, he were man. Though he were man, he were God. Be careful how you refer to his humanity. Although he were. But what does the devil say? Read the words. What does he say? The exact same thing he did to Eve, only repackaged with a different ribbon on it. If, he says, if you are what? What's he creating in his mind? Now, in our book, in our religion today, he would have had every right to submit to that, right? Now, well, we can't hold him responsible for that. He was hungry and tired. Right? Would the Father have held him to that standard? Would he? A royal holy priesthood? Why are we letting the garbage into churches we're letting in, folks? Why? Because we want it. We've been beguiled. Not by the Holy Spirit, but by our own minds, because we like to have our own way. Did Jesus do this for himself? Why did he submit to this? What was the purpose? This was his opening act of his ministry. You might argue at the wedding, which was just prior to this. Oh no, I'm sorry, it was after this, I'm wrong. This was his opening act after his baptism. This was his first work. Why go through such torture? Was it for me or for him or the same reason he did that? Why? Well, let's see what the prophet has to say. Don't take my word for it. She says here, Christ was our example in all things. This is Mrs. White. As we see his humiliation in a long trial at a feast in the wilderness to overcome the temptation of appetite in our behalf. What does that mean? See, up to this point, he hadn't eaten anything wrong. Otherwise, the devil wouldn't be tempting him on it. Is that fair to say? What was the first sin we committed? What was it? What was the first lust for man? Appetite. What did he have to come overcome first on our behalf? Appetite. Isn't that amazing? The more things change, the more they stay the same. She says, in our behalf, we are to take this lesson home to ourselves when we are tempted. If the power of appetite is so strong upon the human family, and its indulgence so fearful that the Son of God subjected himself to such a test, how important that will feel that the necessity of having appetite under control of reason. You know, and that was a period. Under the control of reason. Was Eve under the control of reason when she did what? Well, was Adam under the control of reason when he disobeyed what the Lord said about their industry? Or was he too busy and thought everything was fine? That's theology, folks. See, Adam was using theology at that point. Well, it's okay, we're safe, we're in the garden. Let's apply that to today. I'm safe, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I go to church on Sabbath, I pay my tithe. I ate veggie burgers. Well, of course, that's not even a prerequisite in the church anymore, either, to be a vegetarian. Matter of fact, it's frowned upon. Yep. Well, if you're a real vegetarian, they don't want it. See, and again, we have different words today, Robert, vegan and vegetarian. There's only one vegetarian. Vegan's a political thing. It's a movement. Because they won't even wear belts made out of animals, you see. And I can make the argument that Jesus ate flesh after his resurrection. It's in the Bible. But Paul says he's a vegetarian because of spiritual reasons. Clearly, in 1 Corinthians. It is a spiritual thing. He says it. Ooh, people hate that. Have you ever read that verse to them? And this is not warfare in the sense of argument. It is warfare spiritually. But it is warfare. But when people, oh, well, you know, that's your church. No, Paul was a vegetarian. No, he wasn't. Really? 1 Corinthians, what does he say about eating meat? And it's clear because the translations, he uses the word flesh food. He doesn't just say meat, which means food. No, no, he's very specific. And he says he does it because of what? Spiritual reasons. That's the higher reality, isn't it? So how can our church condone going against what the prophet says on our diet? Whether it's one extreme or the other, folks, because the independents are all over this with, oh, you can't use this and don't do that, but I don't find that in the spirit of prophecy. Matter of fact, some of the things that are forbidden by our gurus are in the spirit of prophecy to be used for our health. Who are you going to follow? Depends how you've been beguiled. You, meaning us, meaning me too. I'm no better than anybody else. You see. Who are you going to follow? Because I can take this book out of my briefcase here, Counsels on Diet and Health, and you know what's funny? I can contradict probably 10 principles laid down by all the big health people that she says completely opposite. See, this is where the Holy Spirit comes in. Who inspired this? Who inspired them? I don't know. What did Paul say? Oh, would that be lust again? Interesting. Thank you. Would that be lust again? Desire for power? A desire for knowledge? Why don't we just go out in that world and act like Jesus and you'll get all the attention you want? And then some. Good and bad. Mostly bad. But that's good. Yes, Rita. I have to say that.
Jesus had to overcome appetite for us. But that doesn't necessarily mean food. Because people can have an appetite for anything. They can have an appetite for power. They can have an appetite for drink. They can have... I mean, it goes on and on.
Yes.
It's lusting for something.
Well, did you hear what she says? The control of reason. It's just a vehicle the devil uses. I mean, it's a joke about, well, it used to be nowadays women don't cook, unfortunately. It's not a desirable trait in a woman to learn how to cook and feed her family because that's not politically correct, which is sad because it's destroyed this country, this world. But... the way to a man's heart is where? That's not a lie. Can we prove that biblically? It's a joke today, isn't it? Or was. I don't know anymore if it is. McDonald's has that. Okay. Burger King has that. Kentucky Fried Chicken restaurants, that's absolutely correct. But I tell you, the way to a man's demise is through his stomach. Does the Bible prove that? What went on at the foot of Sinai, folks? What does the record say? They ate and drank and got up to play. What happened to their reason? What did they just see happen, folks, a week earlier? Or maybe a month earlier? What did these people just see? They were not Jews either. I don't want to hear that. They were Babylonians. What did they just see? Who was there? What did they see? One of the deepest bodies of the water in the world. How many people realize that the Red Sea is extremely deep for what it is? Extremely deep. Was parted. And the most powerful military, it'd be like the American military being wiped out just like that by a weird event. Would you be a little shocked? So they ate and drank and got up to play. So there you have it. Food, music. You think there was music? And what did the play mean? What were they doing? Oh, yeah, they were dancing all right. Oh, yeah. They were dancing all right. See, any religion short of Christianity, true Christ's Christianity, sex is a big part of it. Has everything to do with it. It's a big part of it. Because to the devil, it's part of his religion. Do you know that at black masses, when they practice them properly, the priest has to have relations with three prostitutes at midnight before they perform their mass? And if the devil said to the church, or the Lord said to the church, the first century Seventh-day Adventist church, the devil is your father, what was going on in the church sexually? What happened between a Pharisee and Mary? What happened? What was going on? And who was accused and who wasn't? See my point? Do you think it's any different today? What does Paul say about preachers going into houses and taking captive, empty-headed women? What does he say about that? What does he think he's talking about? What do you hear through all these churches going on? The Catholic Church, homosexuality is rampant through it. Why do you think it just got legalized, folks? Make no doubt about it, that came right from Rome because they're getting eaten up with lawsuits. Their last pope had to resign because he was involved in this. And you hear nothing of it. He can't leave the Vatican because he's going to be indicted. Did you know that? Where is that on CNN? So, we hear constantly, there was just a case here. In this town, Apopka, well, this isn't Apopka, where a high-level church worker was molesting young boys. You see? And everybody, I'm shocked, really? Be careful who you put your children in charge of, because the Bible says the mother is supposed to be in charge of them. Not daycare, not a public school system, not the local preacher or his wife. Who's supposed to be in charge of that child? Biblically. Deny it all you want, but it's there. Who is in charge of the most, if you will, important child that ever set foot on this earth? No, not if you will. It's a matter of fact. Who was in charge of him? The Sanhedrin? Who fought to keep him out of their hands? Who put up with great, great public disgrace and everything because she wouldn't allow this? Who did it? It was Jesus and it was Mary that fought because Joseph was gone. So she, the mother, fought for that child. Reggie, the visitor in the back wants to say something.
You know, Paul, getting back to what you were talking about with the Israelites at Mount Sinai, that they ate and drank and then rose up to play. You know, Paul, in light of the eating and the drinking, if Daniel had not practiced temperance in his eating and in every other aspect of health, the book of Daniel would not have had his name on it. It would have been written by somebody else. So the value and the necessity of living by health principles is absolutely crucial and critical in the Christian life.
Amen. Good point. Thank you. So this all comes under lust. See how the word's been hijacked? There is no such thing as lust of the eyes and lust of the flesh, and it's all one deal. Lust of the eyes, folks, powers Muslim religion. Did you know that? Why did I say that? What do they believe? Why do women wear burqas in the religious and Muslim or in those religions? Why? What is a burqa? They cover the body, only thing is the eyes. Do you know the reason for that? Because they're tempting men. It's not fair to the man. Is that right? Is that right? I've heard Seventh-day Adventists, so-called, say that women in this church shouldn't wear sleeveless shirts or dresses, that they have to be sweeping the floor, which Mrs. White says they should not be, because it's temptation to the man. Whose problem is that? Then I tell that man, you shouldn't leave your house. Or turn on your television. Well, I wouldn't say that. Really? Really? That's lust of the eyes. That's control, folks. That's simply control. And the Catholics with the habits. Why do you suppose they wear all that garbage? They're not tempting anybody. Really? So who's that putting authority of the Holy Spirit in whose hand? God's or man's? Isn't that interesting? So lust is lust, an unlawful, unusual desire to break the law. We bring that into perspective. Whenever you think of that, what did the devil do in heaven? What was he seeking after? Power. Position. Authority. Whatever. Rita?
This is all covered by the 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet.
Isn't that interesting?
It's wanting something that you are not supposed to have.
Why does James have it in the first chapter of his letter? How many times he talks about temptation? In that first chapter, it's all about that. He's a leader of the church. What's he talking about? Why? How many times does he deal with it? We've been looking at it here. Let me finish this statement and then I want to move on. She says, our Savior fasted nearly 6 weeks that he might gain for man the victory upon the point of appetite, which you can take and make reason the reason. The cheeseburger cannot sin, folks. The fruit on the tree that the devil tempted her with was incapable of sin. The tree was incapable of sin. Who was capable of sin? Only one there. Only one. And it was lust that drove it. Only one. That was her. And what did the devil do? He instilled his thoughts into her head. That's not possible. Really? What did she want to become? What did he say?
Like
Reginald. Like God. What was the devil's, what's he trying to do? What does the Bible say? I will ascend my throne above the Most High, he says. You will serve me. What did he say at the end? Bow to me, he said to God. And I'll give you all of this. But Jesus knew he already owned all of it, and he didn't have to bow to the devil. Just like we own it if we don't bow to him. Bill?
You know, Paul, it's fascinating to me listening to people when they talk about evolution, creation, the age of the earth, etc., where all the worldly wise men will poo-poo the idea of a six-day creation story in Genesis chapter 1. But, Paul, in the lives of every single human being, us included, we all have a tree of knowledge of good and evil.
Absolutely.
We all have one where the Lord says, I place it here where you now have choice. And if you eat of it, it's going to destroy you. And all of us have a tree of knowledge of good and evil in our life today. And by the grace of God, we can all resist the temptation to eat at that forbidden tree.
Amen.
And praise the Lord that he stepped in so that we could have power to shun the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
But what's that power you're talking about? What would you call that power? What was the name she used it here, the word? The power of?
I would say the power of Christ by faith.
Well, no, I mean in your mind.
Oh, the power of choice.
Reason.
Reason, yeah.
But that comes right from here. We have no power of reason if the Holy Spirit doesn't abide in the temple. It's funny that this is called the temple. Where is that found? What does that cover, that helmet? See, that's your armor, protecting your thought process, provided the Holy Spirit is leading it. And the only way we can have the Holy Spirit is how, folks? How? By keeping God's law. If we do not keep God's law, we cannot have the Holy Spirit abiding in us. The Shekinah glory in the temple, and I'm going to prove that. When they sinned, what happened? Where did it go? Anybody could walk in and out of the Holy of Holies. Ergo, Eli's sons. How did they get the ark out of there without being zapped? Because there was no divine presence there. The Holy Spirit was gone. You see? I know everybody says that was God, but you better go back and see what it really, who really was above those angels, in that it was the Holy Spirit. Just as holy, just as divine as Jesus and the Father. You see? When he was gone, that was just another building. Eli's sons did what in that building? They took the ark out. Was the ark holy? Was this piece of rock and the manna inside it, was that holy? Of course not. It was just another idol, evidently, to them. They found out afterward that God treasured it greatly, because the Philistines showed more respect for it than the Israelites did. What did they do when they got it, when the Philistines sent it back to them and said, we don't want this thing? What did they do? They were going to make money on it. Make merchandise of men and their souls. Has anything changed? What did they do? They lined up to look inside it. How many of them died that day? Tens of thousands. The Philistines had more respect for that ark because they at least put it in their temple next to Dagon. But Dagon fell on his face. And they said, whoa. Then they started getting boils and sores. And, well, we better return this thing. You see, heathens had more respect than the high priest of Israel did for the ark. To them, it was just an idol. So if the Holy Spirit does not dwell in the temple, it is not holy. Anybody can go in there. See my point? Ichabod, if we're not correct, if we're not protected by our armor, guess who has can walk in and out of our brain anytime he wants? And fill us full of lust. Because that's our nature. And that doesn't mean that the men are going to run down to the local brothel. No, it's everything and anything. Let's go to 1 Timothy. Whatever the devil pleases at that point, you see? Whatever he pleases. 1 Timothy 6. I was going to read starting at 1, because remember I spoke originally about prejudice. Paul deals with that here. I'm not going to, because I want to read a quote out of one of Mrs. White's books. He deals with that. If everybody's content where they are when they are converted, will there be racism and prejudice? Will there? Can the devil stir the pot? Reason again, isn't it? Who made the colors? Who did it? Who did it? Will they disappear after the second coming? Will everybody be one color? What does Paul say? What does he say? You will be known as... Did Jesus change colors when he came out of the grave? Ooh. And I hear many arguments about what color he was. But you know what? When I look at the Arabs, I see all different colors. Do you? I see black as black, and I see white hair, or a white skin and blue eyes. He is our Savior unto all. So if you're not happy with what you are here, you ain't going to go there. Paul says, be happy. And I would think that if he was going to change everybody's color, then we would want to be that color, right? But why are Christians arguing over race? Why are we divided into different divisions of this culture, that culture, this conference, that conference? Wow. Whose idea was it that there's Babel in the earth? God's or man's? I know what you're going to say. Well, God's the one that confounded the languages. Yeah, why? Why did he do that? Because of man's arrogance. But there's only going to be one language in heaven. So there's only one culture, you see. What language is that, by the way? Mrs. White tells us. Canaan. She says that. She was visiting a planet and Enoch was there. And I know that sounds bizarre, doesn't it? Especially with new Star Trek movie coming out. That she was visiting a planet. She didn't even have the Enterprise. Oh, that's old news. But anyhow, and they were conversing. Enoch was talking with one of the inhabitants, and she said she wished that she what? Could speak the language of Canaan so she could understand what they were talking about. So it gives us an insight into what heaven speaks. Who here knows what the language of Canaan is? Who's ever spoken it? So should we not want to aspire to that culture? Oh, wait a minute. That might be the culture of heaven. So what does that do with racism? What does that do with culture? What does that do with nationality? Why are we fighting about this? Because who wants it? Divide and do what? Don't get caught up in that garbage. I don't care what color you are. Don't get caught up in that garbage. Nice haircut, Dennis. I got one this week, too. Don't get caught up in that garbage. It is a total deception. It's nothing but politics and theology. And who was the first politician, by the way? Who politicked through the universe to destroy God's universe? Who did it? Satan, first politician ever. Jesus very easily could have stood there and said, you're of your father, that politician, the devil. Because he was a liar and a murderer from the beginning, and so are you. You see? Beware of political correctness because it's thought control. My wife and I had that talk about that up here, coming up here. Folks, this all comes under lust. Wanting control, wanting power, wanting to be like God. Is that not what he said to Adam and Eve? I will raise my throne above the Most High. Isn't that what he says in Ezekiel, or what the prophet says is going on in his head? So where does that leave us? Fodder for his cannon. So without this on our head, okay, we are just that, because he walks in and out as he pleases. There is no protection. So I was the beginning of all that, and you know what? Well, no, let's just get down to this. What time is it, Jim? Okay. Yeah. Verse 10. Yeah. This is another very misunderstood verse in the Bible, and used greatly. 1 Timothy, chapter 6. Do I want to read this now? Decisions. I'm going to do something. It's a quick read here that I very rarely ever do. However, it's quite important that these verses are understood in the context of further written. And I'm going to read this out of a different version of the Bible. Mind you, this is not the Bible. This is a study tool. And I strongly recommend that any time you open it, you have the real Bible there to make sure the verses are pure. However, it can be used as a tool. It says here, I don't think I've ever done this here before, however, but it's important to understand. Because reading through the other, if you don't pay close attention, you can get pretty twisted around and come away with a different understanding if you don't research it. It says here, and this is verse 1. No, I'm going to read this. It doesn't matter. All who are under the yoke of slavery should consider their masters worthy of full respect, so that God's name and our teachings may not be slandered. Now, who's he talking about here? Who's Paul talking about when he says all who are under the yoke? Those who have been converted to Christianity. Those who have become followers of Christ. And mind you, folks, saying this back then, everybody enslaved everybody back then. There were slaves from all over the world, owned by people from all over the world. So to single out one race is ridiculous. It's stupid. He was in Rome, whether he was in Greece or Rome, there were slaves from all over the world, owned by people from all over the world. This is a blanket statement. In other words, forget your culture, forget your condition, live up to what? What's he saying? We're enslaved here right now. We're just too stupid to know it. If you don't believe me, don't pay your taxes. See what happens. You think you own your house? Don't pay your taxes. See what happens. Who owns it? What's going to happen to it? You're renting it from them. That is extremely not biblical. What did it say in Israel about owning property? You could never lose it. Right, Dennis? Even if you sold it after so many years, what would happen? It would revert back to the family. What was the reason for that? So nobody was homeless or without work. You see? Don't pay your... If you don't think you're enslaved, you got another thing coming. It's just a different slavery. That's why you got to be careful about people running around telling, "Oh, we got to revolt against the country," or if you're a member here, or if you're a citizen there, you're not going to heaven. Really, that's not what I'm reading here. Whatever your condition is, those who have believing masters are not to show less respect for them because they are brothers. Now, that's an interesting statement, too. What is Paul saying? Well, you're a believer, you should give me my freedom. Isn't that what he's saying? Oh, you're not a Christian if you don't. Isn't that what he's saying? Ooh, isn't that interesting? So why are all these reverends causing all this problem when they claim to be what? Shouldn't they be going the other way? There was one who did that, and he got his head blown off. Who was that? Martin Luther King Jr. He applied this, so they killed him. It wasn't what they wanted. And you know it was an FBI guy that shot him? Did you know that? That's a matter of fact. Put a bullet in him. So, this is all the devil's control. This all comes under lust. People are going down these roads because they want what they don't have. And he knows how to do the tweaking, folks. It'd be pretty nice to believe this because then you don't have to get involved in all this political mess that's going on. Where can we turn our energies? Where can we turn our energies? To the truth. Did Jesus get involved in the injustices going on in Jerusalem? Did he even mention them? Why? You have to change man's heart and mind before any of this will change. Jesus was discriminated against strongly by his own people. Why? Where was he from? He was a ghetto urchin, a member of the lower classes. You see, he knew what discrimination was. He knew what racism was. He knew what social injustice was, more so than we have any idea. Paul goes on to say here, instead, they are to serve them even better because those who benefit from their service are believers and dear to them. These are the things you are to teach and urge on them. Is that what we're hearing in our churches? Or are we all told we're victims? One way or another, whether it's a white church, a black church, a Hispanic church, aren't we all victims now? We all have rights. We have the right to be cast into the lake of fire because we're born here sinful. That's the only right we have. We have the privilege of becoming members of heaven, citizens of heaven, but it's a whole different set of laws. I have to stop there because we're out of time. We're going to pick this up next time right there. Because I didn't get to the verse I was really shooting for, and I'm sure you know which one it is. Because that's another very misquoted verse. The love of money is the root of all. That's only applied to rich people, right? They're the only ones that can break that. Really? I beg to differ. And we're going to take a look at that because it brings us to whom? Judas. Was he rich? Mm-mm. But that's what killed him. Anyhow, folks, it's an incredible study. I love the book of James because you know what? I don't need to answer to any man, and that's not arrogance. But I need to be humble and meek and subservient, don't I? But I don't violate heaven's principle because somebody has something hanging on their wall. A lot of stuff sticks to walls, folks. Okay? A lot of stuff sticks to walls. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before your most mighty and incredible throne, Lord. We praise you for the simplicity of your word and the freedom you give us to practice as you would have us so. May we use our reason and our minds, Father, to serve you. Be with us this Sabbath day that your spirit is here amongst us, that we may overcome evil, but that our worship and our service is acceptable. We ask your forgiveness and we crave your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.